Welcome back, everybody, to your daily update on the state of the Malazan Empire. And today we're gonna talk about Reaper's Gale because I started it today and I'm excited. I really enjoy the book and yeah, we'll get started with that today. A quick thing, Fantastic Philosophy, who is definitely one of the people who comment the most under my videos, and I'm really, really thankful for that, asked whether I could maybe actually play some of the music I sometimes talk about in my videos. I'm not sure how to do that. I'm also not sure how many people would actually like that I try to sort of keep the metal side and the book side of my life separated here, because I don't want to bore you all with music stuff, and otherwise I would also not want to bother people that are into the music part with book stuff. But maybe I can figure out some way to actually combine the two, maybe make like a special video on, I don't know, the influence of fantasy literature on heavy metal, or the other way around, or whatever. I have no idea, but if you really would like to see something like that at some point, then just, you know, make a comment, I guess. Anyway, that's that. And now also, yeah, now let's go into the video. So, Reaper's Gale. Cheers. All right, there's, so I've basically read the first three chapters and the prologue of Reaper's Gale today. First book is called The Emperor in Gold. We already kind of figure out what that might be about, among other things. And the overall part is, once again, I feel it's similar to some of the other books, early books in some of the volumes. I guess it's similar to what you have in, I don't know, Deadhouse Gates or Garden of the Moon, definitely Gardens of the Moon. And when we kind of reconnect or retouch, get back in touch with characters that we haven't seen for a while, you know, similar as it was with Bone Hunters, the beginning of the Bone Hunters, After Midnight Tides, that kind of thing. So we meet a lot of new characters, but we also meet some of our some people we've met before, mostly in Midnight Tides, because obviously we're back in Letharas, or the Lethar Empire, under under Edor rule. And not much has changed, and the little that has changed has not changed for the better, or so it seems. So we kind of catch up to what has happened during the Bone Hunters, I guess. Not after the end of Midnight Tides, we see some of that in, you know, flashback scenes and stuff like that. We learn how it came about that Trollsengar was Sean or not Sean. You know, these kind of things. So there's that. And that obviously also means that there's not yet that much of like really new and deep thought going on there, I guess. I mean, obviously there is, because this is still Malazan and not not just the society pages of your newspaper. So we get some, obviously some interesting stuff in there as well. And the first big thing we see there is that how the Lethar society, how Letharas society with has like basically embraced and taken hold of the Tyst Edor society, and how basically we have Letharas only more so, and the Tyst Edor have not managed to impose any part of their cultural, like cultural civilization, onto the Lethar Empire. So the structure, the capitalist dry underpinnings of the Lethar Empire have proven much stronger than the ideology, the culture of the Tyst Edor. Now there's obviously a lot of question on why that is, and Stephen Erickson has at some point, like several times, explained about the idea that he had with Midnight Tides and and Reaper's Gale, about the question, what if First Nations, Native Americans would have managed to actually conquer Washington and take over, what would have happened? And the idea, obviously, His answer to this question obviously seems to be, well, they just have turned into capitalists exploiting the poor people, just like the people that are in power. So there is something in there that I guess we need to talk about more throughout this. And that means that some forces, some groups, yeah, some forces are very much not like... to be not can't be really stopped in a way and have like this very virulent power to just infect and turn and change everything they touch. There's a, like cultural ideas, I guess, political or cultural ideas that go in that direction. And obviously the idea of capitalism, whether you like it or not, is one of those ideas. The idea of a society that is built on monetary or material wealth as its gradient, as what defines classes. That is a very, very powerful structure that is very difficult to get rid of, I guess, is the words that we need here. So yeah, there's that, and we see a lot of that shown up in like these small, almost vignette-style opening viewpoints within the first two, three chapters. We have that. We have two Tyst Edur who seem to struggle with the whole situation, who seem to struggle with how things, like how society works. That's Bruth and Trana, and what's the other name? Brulhandar, the one in Dreen, and the new overseer there, who's basically just a figurehead, and everyone is running circles around him, because yeah, the Lethari are basically not taking the barbarians seriously in any case, in any way. So there's that, and that's. Those, I feel, are the argument of how, not the argument, but the example of how someone who has a certain, like, honesty, nobility, I don't want to say nobility, nobility is a wrong word here, but he has, like, a certain honesty and character, is rooted in their personal, like, traditions and stuff like that, how they are failing to comprehend, failing to understand the society they have conquered, and are just run over by it, or... yeah, are very, very ineffective. We see that in those two cases, because both of them seem to try their own, like, you know, try to do their best, I guess. But it doesn't work because the system has taken over and they are just flotsam on that system and they'll be crushed by it sooner or later. We also meet for the first time Karas Invictad and Tarnal Yathwana, I guess, is his assistant. The new secret police, the Patriots of Letheras. And those will be very interesting to talk about in the future. I am, in fact, looking at doing a special video on that part, on the secret police, or the presentation of secret police, a representation of secret police within fantasy stories. And I feel there might be some other names be mentioned in there in that video as well, of like comparable or maybe not so comparable characters in other books, like Findy Swing in Terry Pratchett's Nightwatch, or Sand and Glockta in the First Law trilogy. So we'll see how that goes. Today we just start seeing them operating. We see the sheer arrogance of Karas Invictad towards the Tyst Edur, and how he, basically him and, I already forgot his name, the rich bastard, I can't remember his name right now because I'm an idiot. The head of the Liberty Consign, how they have basically managed to combine economic interest with this construction of a secret police, and the partnership between the two that manages to make both of them richer and richer and richer while spreading fear and making the situation actually even more stable and less volatile than it was before. There's obviously also a lot of arrogance within... within Karas Invictad. We might have to look at that arrogance at another point, I guess, when we have more of him. But yes, So we have that situation. The Liberty Consign as like in general the partnership between what you might call the economic sector and the policing sector is a brutal one, and there's certainly, I guess there's lessons in there that we might draw out from there when it comes to privatization of something like the legal system, right? That is a definite problem because basically we see those two, basically we see them using cheap most likely false information to accuse the owner of that one hostelry and pub and tavern or whatever it was to they accuse him of treachery. They basically kill him, and the his hostelry then falls to the Liberty Consign and the and Carus Invicta and some others. So there is economic drive behind that. We also see there's that, and we will need to talk about more about that because that's the point. It's like if your police system, if your justice system has an economic incentive to find you guilty of something, there is obviously a certain there's something going on there, and people might just be more often guilty than they might be if there is no economic drive behind having more people in, like having more people found guilty. That's what I'm trying to say there. So there is that. That's certainly not gonna, look good for that doesn't look good for the future of the Lethar Empire. What else do we have? We see corruption being a even more like an even bigger issue in other parts, like the further out you get from the center of the empire, when we talk about the factor of Dreen, who is waging that war against the Aldan, against the All, to basically enrich himself. And Brothendrana realizes all of that. Not Brothendrana, Brohandar realizes all of that, but there's not much he can do about it, apparently, because he doesn't understand the system. And yeah, that's certainly the bit that we should that shows a lot that is going like always went wrong with or yeah always went wrong with your basic colonialisms, right? You have people that are sent there on an official posting, but then use the forces of the state to privately enrich themselves. Like, go read Heart of Darkness if you want reminding of that, or just look at a history book of like any colony happening in the last, I don't know, 500 years, probably before that, although with colonies in the antique, like ancient world, especially colonies under the Greek name of colony, there's a difference in how that works, I guess. But I mean, this is not a seminar on colonialism in the Mediterranean before the Common Era, is it? So we're not going to go there, but we see the behavior happening there is it's basically the same thing that also happened in a way in Seven Cities and led to the rebellion in Seven Cities. So there's that. It just seems that in the case of the All, it doesn't happen. We don't get that rebellion because the All seem to be thoroughly outgunned and outnumbered by the Lethari at this point. So yeah, there's that. There is some other things that we need to talk about. One, the group of refugees with Seren Pedak and Celestia's Ruin and so forth. On their flight, we have a joyful reunion with our friend Udinas, who is once again a barrel of fun. But there is an interesting situation there, and that's definitely one that I'm not going to go too deeply into that today because I feel I've spoken a lot about the whole monomyth situation, but there's this great scene when they're climbing up the mountain there, and Udinas is giving that speech to Or it's in the mountain already? Yeah, it's in the mountain. Like Udinese is giving that speech to fear, and like this is not, you know, the kind of legend or mythology you imagine yourself in. This is not that mythic tale, but because, you know, we have all the archetypes assembled here. Now, if you've read your Joseph Campbell, you know that he's very much going for these for Jungian archetypes, and a lot of these things were the ideas that were that are persistent, like that are important in Campbell's and a lot of other people's work during that time. And the way it's done is a very nice comment on all of that, but there's an important truth in there that Udinese points out, and that is, and it's comes close to my own personal criticism of the Joseph Campbell hero with a thousand faces monomyth kind of thing. And that is for me the fact that a lot of us use this idea of mythology, of a specific narrative, to build our own lives into that, to think ourselves into these kind of like narratives, to use them to justify our actions and so forth. And that is, on the one hand, is a very human, very natural thing. We all think narratively. That's just how humans work, as far as I know, or as far like from like what I think. Like we work. Human consciousness is a narrative consciousness nowadays, is what I'm trying to say here. It's like we think actions have consequences. We try to construct our like past actions and our present actions into an overarching narrative that is basically the story of our lives. Some people actually get down and write those things up as their autobiographies, but the idea is that we think of our lives not as a series of random events, but as an ongoing narrative that has some overarching sense or sense to it, some overarching meaning to it, I guess. And that by itself, as I said, is nothing. There's nothing inherently wrong with that by itself. That's fine. That's just like how humans are. The problem is that if too many people use a specific pattern, a specific narrative, and use that one as the model they model their own lives after, or they think that's the narrative they're in. For example, that hero's journey that Joseph Campbell came up with, because apart from him just writing about folklore, which he didn't understand, he also tried, and people afterwards, even more so, used his idea of like these are like this is the myth, the human myth, this is the story, the hero's journey story. And there's reasons for that, and that's because they're so closely meshed to our own personal experience. And that, on the other hand, like can lead us to using that story, that hero's journey, as a model for our own life to get our own, you know, to get ourselves out of trouble or build our personality and so forth. And then we suddenly end up in the self-help community, and we all know how that's gonna turn out. And the answer is not good. And that's the warning I feel in there that Udinese gives. Like, you might think yourself in that hero's journey fear. But beware if you assume that people are not behaving like that. That hero's journey doesn't happen like that. And people are not archetypes. People are people. They're more complex, more subtle, and things pan out in a different way. Another thing in there is, though, and that's something that I find interesting, on the other hand, it's like one of those patterns that, for that Campbell, for example, drags up, and I feel he's got a point there, is that a lot of times you have these stories about a group of heroes, not a group of heroes, but like brothers that all set out to, you know, we know that from fairy tales, that it's a pattern that actually, that obviously exists out there. I wouldn't, you know, drag it into the main monomyth thing, but the idea of having like three brothers that all try to attempt the same thing, usually it's the youngest brother, which in this case would be Rulad, who succeeds at a specific task, but the other two have failed before. And this time around, it's sort of twist, you know, turned on its head. It's like Rulad went on a quest, and Fear has realized he has failed, so Fear is now in that pattern. He decides to go and attempt the same thing, which is to save the Tis Dedur. Only it's obviously for him no longer the idea of finding a sword for Hanan Masak or for himself, but it is, in the end, his plan is to find Skabandari Bloodeye to do whatever he wants to do, and I'm pretty sure he doesn't know himself right now. But yeah, there's that. And that's an interesting point to look at as well, that how you could apply this method, like how you can find, if you look at it, how you can find parts of what you might call the hero with a thousand faces, or what you might call the hero's journey narrative, main thing that Campbell writes about, how you can find bits and pieces everywhere. And the question then obviously is that because people are aware of the monomyth as an idea and pattern it accordingly to that? Or is the lens just so broad that you can find it somewhere, that you find bits of it somewhere? So, I mean, I know what my thoughts are about that, but, you know. Anyway, just wanted to point that out, and I didn't want to ramble too much about it again, because I feel we've spoken a lot about the monomyth, so maybe let's not go too deeply into that right now. Another thing that I found interesting is just like a short observation. It's in chapter 2, I guess, or maybe 3, I don't know, where Tanal Yathwana, I probably pronounced his name wrong. Anyway, where he is talking to the scholar, I need to get used to those names again. Anyway, he's talking to her and about moral relativism and quoting, and she's quoting her treatise, or at least giving a summary of that thing, of one of her lectures. And that is one where I feel that we are very, very close to Steven Erikson as an author. That's the bit about cultural relativism and moral relativism, and that some things are inherently wrong and can be seen as inherently wrong, even though they are, you know, rooted in tradition. And that's something that I feel comes back when you look at like Erikson's treatment of certain cultural aspects within the Malazan Book of the Fallen, whether it's, you know, the idea of female genital mutilation in Deadhouse Gates, and not Deadhouse Gates, mostly in House of Chains, or whether it's stuff that we see later on. It's just like, just because this is a tradition and just because it is specific to a certain culture, that doesn't mean it's inherently good. There are certain practices that are wrong, no matter what. And cultural relativism or moral relativism is obviously the wrong answer there, because it's wrong. That's something that we find in there, and I feel that this is very close to Steven Erikson's own, I don't want to say beliefs, but... Well, he's basically said as much in one of his essays. So yeah, I feel confident in saying that this is close to the author of the Malazan Book of the Fallen as we can get in some of like these things, like his personal voice coming out there almost. I just wanted to, you know, mention that. What else is interesting in these first three chapters? Obviously, we see that Tehol is still doing stuff. He's still trying to ruin the economy, which is cool. There's a lot of your usual absurd comedy kind of thing when you have these conversations between Bug and Tehol, or Tehol and Rocket and all and so forth. But nothing too extreme so far in that. I just feel they might also be interesting to look at the conversations. That's going to be something that I'll look at in the next chapters as well. To compare the relationship between Bug and Tehol, like Tehol and Bug on the one hand as like a master-servant relationship, which, you know, it still kind of is on the one hand. And for example, Karas Invictad and his Tanal Yathvan. I'm sorry. On the other hand, how those, because both are built on having these highly sophisticated discussions of a lot more than just passing orders around. So I feel that might be an interesting thing to see how those two mirror each other. And that's something that I want to get back to in the next couple of chapters and see how that develops there. So yeah, there's that. What else? Oh yeah, there's a thing that I still need to figure out, and I'm not even sure if it's ever gonna be cleared up within the Malazan Book of the Fall. Maybe it's something that we'll find in Carcanas. I'm not quite sure. And that's the whole question of what the fuck did the Kachin Chamal do to creation? Because apparently that's what precipitated the war, and it was mentioned before in probably Midnight Tides, I feel, where it's and now it's kind of mentioned again about the Kachin Chamal did something at some point that wounded creation itself and assured that creation itself will end one day. So my question is, like, did they just invent entropy, or how does that work? And I'm still trying to figure it out. I have no idea so far. So that's going to be something that I'll try to figure out in the next couple of books and see what I if that's ever, coming up again, or what that whole thing is. Apart from that, we apparently now have life could change Jamal again. So there's that. That's cool because we all love dinosaurs, don't we just? What else was there? I feel that's sort of all I wanted to talk about today, so there's that. I hope you have a great Wednesday. I'll be back tomorrow with more Reaper's Gale, and then we'll see how things develop. Until then, cheers.